Hi there, and welcome to the Living with SMA podcast. We're here to have conversations about living with spinal muscular atrophy. Throughout this podcast, we will be covering lots of different topics, from preparing for university, getting the most from your personal budget, sex and relationships, and lots more. So we invite different hosts from across the SMA community to come together here. We want to answer your questions, provide you with useful tips and recommendations, and also share personal stories. So please do reach out and connect with us here at the charity SMA UK. Thank you for listening, and we hope you find the podcast useful.
Welcome everyone to this episode of SMA UK's podcast. Today we're talking about PAs and how PAs are not just for her. I'm Michaela Hollywood. I have SMA type 2 and I'm 31 years old. I'm going to let Louie and Katy introduce themselves before we go any further. Louie, would you like to introduce yourself first?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. So I'm Louie and I have SMA type 2 and I'm 36 years old now.
Brilliant. And Katy?
Hi, I'm Katy. I also have SMA type 2 and I am 49.
Brilliant. So we've got a little range of experiences here today. So what is a PA? I think we probably all have our own definitions of what a PA is. But for me, a personal assistant is the arms and legs and the physical power behind me, enabling me to do what I want to do with my life. They don't necessarily take care of me, but what they do is help me to live my life in the way that I want to. Some people might assume that it's always someone within the family who is a PA, and we're here to challenge that a little bit today. Because actually, for many people in the UK, it's someone from outside of the home, and often a relative stranger who comes in to fulfill the role of a PA. There are an awful lot of differences across the UK around how we fund PAs and where we get the budget from. In Northern Ireland, that's different again to England, Scotland and Wales. So we have a video at the bottom of this video for you to look at, which will look at the differences between continuing healthcare funded or CHC, care and local authority funded social care. So do feel free to watch that and understand the differences in funding. But ultimately, the process will be different for everyone, and it's important to reflect on that. But before we really check in, it's important that people are listened to and that their views are reflected. People should be seen as a person and not as an object to be cared for. Having a PA doesn't mean that we are less than or that we're changed as people. It's really important to reflect on that. So yeah, Katy and Louie, what does having a PA mean to you?
Right, can I go first?
Go ahead.
Okay. So, very similar to what you said, Michaela, a personal assistant is someone who allows me to do as much as I desire, I guess. They are an extension of ourselves and they give us the ability to gain our independence, to integrate ourselves into society far easier than it would be us doing it on our own. And I guess the impact that a PA would have would obviously vary on the severity of your disability, but in my opinion, they are positive additions to our lives, and they allow us to really be everything that we can be and stop worrying about what we can't do and rather look towards what we can do.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you've hit on a note there for me, which is, you know, it's integration into society that is impossible without PIs. Katy, what about you?
Yeah, no, I mean, you've absolutely summed it up in my mind. I would totally agree with everything that you've said. A PA is an enabler at the end of the day. It is our arms and legs, just as you said, Michaela. And without them, you know, we can't live. You know, we can't work. We can't contribute to society. So, I think it's also quite important to sort of highlight the difference between a PA and a carer, which a lot of people don't quite understand. And as it's, you know, we've just explained, that's what a PA does. A carer, I would say, you know, is more about making sure you're comfortable, you're safe, and you're looked after. Whereas a PA is, you know, helping you live a life that you choose, and they're flexible and adaptable, and they adapt to your individual needs. Whereas a carer is kind of more prescriptive and constrained by a fixed routine. So, yeah, a PA, as you said, is our arms and legs. There's no better way to sum that up.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people will say to me, why do I use the term PA? And I will always say, you know, whenever I was in pediatrics, I didn't have control over my life. So whenever I was under the age of 18, I didn't have control of what the carer was allowed to do. But when I turned 18, I was given that control and I could direct them myself. And carer didn't seem like it fit anymore for me because they weren't directing me. I was directing them. And that very much felt like the most natural word that's out there for me. So yeah, I know you're absolutely right. I mean, there's a big difference between a carer and a PA. And for a lot of people, that will be very individual. But I think for all three of us here, we're kind of saying the same thing. It's about being our arms and legs and our physical impact on the environment around us. So yeah.
Yeah, I think just to enforce that, I think the issue between the two is PAs have a lot more freedom to make our lives easier, better, and more rewarding, whereas carers are defined to do their task between certain parameters. And because of legal constraints, because of policy and internal policy, they can't stray from outside of those parameters. And that ends up giving you a very limited lifestyle and a very limited assistance that you can obtain from them.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that hits the nail on the head. You know, it's different in each authority, but for me, I see that very much. You know, if you have a carer, you see they are constrained by what's in the car plan, certainly in my experience. But when you move to having a PA, that kind of evaporates quite nicely. And it prevents them from having to say, well, I'm not allowed to cook an egg. And it can really come down to that. You know, that a car in the community will be allowed to bore you an egg, but a PA can, because they're under your direction. So it is a big part of it, which kind of leads me on to my next question quite nicely. Maybe if you're an egg lover, having a PA who can make the eggs for lunch is a really good positive part of it. But what are some of your positive experiences of PAs? Katy, do you maybe want to go first on this one?
I think probably the biggest one for me is travel. I used to like going on cruises, but and my mum used to come with me because it was just easier. But of course, she got, you know, too old and she was unable to sort of be my sort of carer when we went away anymore. So when I had PAs, I've been around the world on a 4-month cruise with my PA, and that was just one of the most amazing things I've ever done. And I couldn't have done it without them. So, I think travel is probably a really good thing. And also working, you know, if I didn't have a PA, I wouldn't have been able to go to work every day, build a career. So these things are, you know, really important. And they're things that, you know, everyday people take for granted. But it's just that simple level of support just allows me to do those things.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I might have you on the 4 month cruise. It sounds like a lot of fun.
Amazing. Amazing. So lucky to be able to have done that. But yeah.
Absolutely. Lee, what would you say your positive experiences are?
Well, I mean, I would also love to do a cruise. That would be definitely a bucket list item there. I think the best way to explain this would be to go back to the beginning. So I grew up in a very sheltered environment at home where everyone told me I would live with my mum and dad for the rest of my life, and I would be reliant on them. And having a carer allowed me to move out of that environment and become an individual rather than a family-orientated and family-dictated person. It allowed me to really develop a career. Like Katie said, it's also allowed me to do some really exciting things. Because of my carer, I had the opportunity to attend events that I would never have been able to attend because my family don't like that kind of music. I've been able to go and do business meetings, and I've been able to go in a car drifting, and I've been on the back of a superbike, and it's all of these things that people don't realize that we actually want to do, and without a PA, and that's not really possible because, again, your family might not want to be in those places, or they're just not capable of picking you up and putting you in those positions that you need to be, because you don't just have a hoist lying around to get into a vehicle, you know. So and they've really allowed me to be as free as I can be. I mean, we do live our lives within some constraints, but the PA has helped to relieve that barrier drastically.
Yeah, so I also think that it's really important that we can, you know, we can give our families a chance to have their own lives as well. You know, we're not reliant on parents, you know, they need a life, we need a life. And it's just nice also to be able to spend time with family and, you know, spouses on a level which, you know, is an emotional and personal level rather than kind of like, oh, we have to, you know, be a carer or a PA as part of that. And it kind of, you can concentrate on the real emotional connections and quality, spending quality time with your partners or your family. And PAs allow us to do that.
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, if I reflect on some of my experiences, I mean, a bit like, not quite 4 months cruise, but I did spend 2.5 weeks out in the US on an exchange program and had PAs with me there. And it was literally 6 flights in 2.5 weeks, and it was go, 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 go. Without the PAs there, I wouldn't have been able to make that work. And that was a combination of their work, but also the work of the people who were organizing the exchange and recognizing the importance of me having PAs that knew me there. So that was an incredible trip that led to an awful lot of personal development. But reflecting back on something that Lee said, anyone who knows me knows I like my snooker. And when it comes to Northern Ireland and there's a ranking event, I tend to be there. So there's been plenty of times it's been a bit like tag team as to who has to go with me. But it allows me to go and enjoy something that I really, really enjoy, and that is a real special interest for me, but that isn't for most people, to be fair. So, you know, I get to sit and watch, you know, the best players in the world lift trophies, and that is something that when I was younger, I didn't think I would ever be able to do. But then to add on to that, the fact that I was able to learn to drive, and I was able to drive myself to one of the highlights of my year, being able to go and watch the snooker in person and watch every ball and watch 3 attempted 147s in one day. For me, it doesn't get much better than that. And it's about being able to do the things that you want to do in your way. And I think that's that's something that's really hard to put into words. But for me, it all encapsulated into that one event, where I was able to drive myself there. I had my PAs with me. I could do what I wanted on that day. And that all reflects the importance of a PA in life, I think. So I suppose we talked about what a PA does and what they mean to us, but how do you find a PA? What role do you take? Do you go for an agency? Do you employ your own PA? And what is that process actually like? Is it like professional football and you're out looking for and scouting for people, or are you looking for recruitment specialists to find them for you? What is it actually like out in the real world?
So, at the moment, it's a social care funded agency. So I have, it's difficult. I have a couple of regular carers, but because it's a care company, they can't guarantee that consistency that we usually need in order to build routines and relationships with people. I have, on average, in a week, I probably have anywhere between 5 to 6 different people coming into my home at different times, and they have so much staff turnover that it's really hard to get that consistency that I would rely on to be as free as I want to be.
Yeah, absolutely. And Katy, what about you? What's it like?
Yeah, I've had living PAs for 24 years now. I started off having PAs from an agency that was before I got direct payments, I can totally, empathise with Lily's experience. The consistency isn't there. You don't get any choice in how long they stay or who they are. So I couldn't wait to get on direct payments. And as soon as I did, I was employing my own people. But actually, back in those days, which is a long time ago now, it was very hard to recruit PAs. There were no dedicated places where you could go to find people. It was advertising on Gumtree or advertising in the Lady. Then you'd get all sorts of responses, and it was time consuming. I had a full-time job, and just any recruitment exercise took ages and didn't always kind of produce what you wanted. So that was when I kind of thought, okay, there must be loads of other people in the same situation. How can we solve this? So I came up with the idea for PA Pool, which is a website which connects those who wish to employ PAs with PAs looking for work. So that's where I kind of go now, because it would be wrong if I didn't use my website, basically.
Yeah, absolutely. And PA Pool is one of the tools I've used successfully in the past.
I'm glad to hear that.
In Northern Ireland, I know it's maybe a little bit smaller, but I've managed to pull a few people out of there. But for me, it is very much, if I go back maybe 18 months ago, the vast majority of my applicants came through Facebook. Because I was able to create a job post on Facebook and share that to local buy and sell groups. So it's a little bit like the buy and sell newspaper you would have got in years gone by. And you were advertising that, but Facebook changed the rules and that was no longer allowed, and that really stripped back my ability to reach people in the local area who were looking for jobs. So I turned to Indeed with mixed success. I suppose at the moment it's a challenging market. I think I've noticed in the last 3 months it seems to be shifting a little bit and becoming a little bit easier, but I think for me, it's really about trying to find the type of people I'm trying to find are people who are willing to learn and who have an open mind. I don't really mind what skills they have. I don't really mind what their background is. All I want to know is that they're able to commit to working the hours that I need them to work, and that they're open to learning a few new things. And providing they have those two kind of key elements I always find, they usually work out well. But I also am pretty agency for in the past. And I really understand where you're coming from, Louie. It can be really difficult when you have, you know, 6 or 7 different people, some of them you don't know their name. It can be really difficult to trust people in that situation. But sometimes
it is. I think I'm trying to navigate my way still because I'm new to the system. As many people will be able to tell by my accent, I'm not from the UK originally. I've only been here for 1 year and 3 months now. So it's really looking at everything on social media and looking at all these other platforms. People are really struggling and people are just posting it everywhere they can. I think PA Pool is a brilliant idea, Katy, and I can definitely see myself trying to use that in the near future because I am trying to go on direct payment so that I have more control of my care. But people are posting on their own Facebook profiles because you can't do it on Marketplace anymore. And you see people that are using Indeed and all the other job sites, and it's hard. And do we really have time to interview so many people as well? Because I think the recent ideology is that anyone can do care. And whilst I agree with that, not everyone is suitable for care because some are doing it for the money and not because they actually want to care. And that's what makes this whole journey so inconsistent and so rocky, because you are having to interview people in the hope that they're going to want to do this job, where sometimes it's just because they want the money. So they're going to be there while you're paying them, but if they find more money elsewhere, they're leaving. So you've got to start again. So it's tough.
Yeah, it is a difficult one. It's, you know, it takes a very special kind of person to be a PA. And, you know, they should be rewarded financially, you know, for doing that work. But as you say, Louie, you know, there are so many other jobs which are easier, which pay more. You know, you can get more money for walking a dog. So it is something, I think funding is definitely something which needs to be addressed. But also, you know, Brexit hasn't really helped either. I mean, because I've got a window on kind of a small part of the care sector, and with PA Pool, I can see, you know, that the numbers have dropped, the numbers of new PAs coming in to work is dropped by a third. I mean, that's a massive, massive drop.
Yeah, and I mean, I had a discussion about this fairly recently, as I'm sure you can tell by my accent. I'm from Northern Ireland, and Northern Ireland being the only part of the UK that didn't vote for Brexit. And when I was having this discussion just yesterday to friends about the crisis in care in Northern Ireland and how are we going to fix it? And, you know, we did discuss, you know, how Brexit has impacted the numbers, but also a bright financial incentive as well. You know, for me, one of the things I would like to be able to do for my PAs is to be able to give them incentives like free cinema tickets or free coffee that they can go use in their own leisure time to reward them for the things that they do and the sacrifices they do make. But right now, the budget isn't there for me to do that. So, and it's one of the things I'm constrained on and I'm not allowed to do. So I think there's an argument about pay, but there's also an argument about how can we maybe not necessarily increase pay, but allow for other incentives in there to really help people see that there's more benefits to PA work than just money. There are other so-called staff benefits that we can offer to people. But I think that kind of brings me on nicely to my next question, which is around the support that's out there for us as an employer and a service user. You know, are there services that you use to support you? And do you feel like there's more that can be done to make you feel safe as an employer, but also someone in receipt of her PA work?
Well, I think from my perspective, because I'm using a care company that's socially funded, I think that there is this, I don't know, it's like they had this brilliant idea that they could come up with a set of rules that would apply to everyone. And whilst companies have these amazing slogans that say people-centered care, independent living, they can't really offer that. They have rules that don't apply to every individual. And I mean, I look at my case. If I go to the high street and I purchase items in a store and we're at the pay point and they take my card out, they tap to pay, it fails. They can't put the card in the machine and use my PIN code. They can't go to an ATM to draw the money for me. So what does that mean? It means I have to leave the items I've just wanted to purchase in the store and come back home because they can't help me with that. I have seen as well in my search for different agencies, because I'm not currently happy with my current provider, that they have different rules as well amongst themselves. So my current provider says that it's a rule that they only allow two people per hoist. So they can't single hoist, it has to be a double up. It can't be a single. Whereas a different agency says that if it's a city hoist, which as you can see behind me I have, they can do that as a single. So right now, I am going to the bathroom in the morning when I wake up. I then have to wait till someone comes in at 11 to assist with bathroom again. So that's about a 3-hour gap. I then have to wait until 1:45 for the next bathroom break, and then usually 4:00 for the next break. So essentially, I'm only going to the bathroom 3 times during the day, which anyone would know that is that's not always possible. Some days you go more than others. So these are the kind of barriers that they're inflicting on service users, because someone who ever started this whole process from the beginning thought that they would be able to cater to everyone, and it doesn't work that way. People need to start realizing that care is about the individual, and it needs to be tailored around the individual, not tailored around your idea of what care that person should get.
Yeah, and I think for me as well, it's about tailoring it around the individuals who receive the care, and us being top of the tree, and not the service being at the top of the tree. The service really only exists because of our need, and really it feels like everything's very upside down. And it always turned on its head, and service users need to come first.
I think another thing to add is I think that my perception is when I look at care companies, it's about getting as many service users as possible to make as much money as possible. But what that means is that carers are having to rush calls, which then lowers the standard of care. We're seeing a massive shortage in carers thanks to Brexit, and we're now hiring anyone that's wanting to apply for the job. And again, that's dropping in the standard of care. There is no criteria for someone to be a carer now. All they say is, if you're willing to work, we'll train you and you can do that job. And whilst that can work for many people, there's still too many hazards. I think I have had people come in my home to do a shadow shift, and they've never come back again because they've realized that this job is harder than they thought. And I think that the companies have a lot of this blame because they don't always tell people what they're getting into. They just say, yep, you want to work, here's your materials, study it. We'll give you the answers so that you pass. As long as your DBS is clear, you can work. And that doesn't help us at all.
No, absolutely. Go ahead, Katy. I mean, what are your thoughts on this? Do you think there's enough support out there?
To be honest, I don't really use much support. I kind of tend to do things myself just for the reasons, you know, that you think if you want a job doing properly, you know, do it yourself, because that's how it's, you know, been for me. But I mean, I'm sure there are plenty of support places out there now. I think there's more now than there's ever been. It's just I haven't had a reason to use it. But, you know, certainly for people stepping into the realm of employing their own personal assistants, you know, there are support organisations out there to help you with the process, to answer questions. You know, there are a lot of independent living support services local to people who can help. I think if you need support, there is support out there.
Yeah, and I mean, I think anyone who knows me in the community will know whether I really will advise people to talk to their insurance company. They are my number one support go-to, especially when you have your own PAs. You know, if you have a problem, ring your insurance company helpline. Many people don't realise that they are out there and that they can support you in times of crisis, but they can also support you on less immediate problems as well. So they are my number one go-to for support. But I think what Louise says is really important as well. There's agencies have a really good place in society, but as we dilute the standard of care, it becomes harder and harder for us as disabled people to use them. And they become more and more untouchable for me the more I hear. I've thankfully been away from agencies for a long time. Never to hear their stories, you know, the nice of not being able to use your PIN number. I mean, that's a really basic thing, to be able to go and buy food so that you have the supplies you need at home. So you know, we've got an awful lot of work to do to fix those problems, I think. But in terms of, you know, we know that there's a lot of staff turnover. You know, we know that caring isn't for everyone. It would be the right way to put it. You know, everyone can care for people, but caring is a different scenario, and it's not for everyone. And that means we do have a high turnover of staff. And we know that probably each of us and everyone else will have different expectations of their PAs at the beginning and at the outset. And so we know there's a lot of factors to take into consideration. You know, when I went to university, I wanted a PA who had a degree so that they would know what I was doing. Other people might want a PA of the same age if they're at university. So, I mean, how long does a PA normally work for you? And what do you normally look for when you are trying to recruit someone and going through those early stages? What are you looking for the person?
I think for me, I mean, PAs have been with me for varying lengths of time. I mean, it's a tough job to be doing kind of long term. It's pretty intensive. You're living my life, you know, rather than your own when you're working with me. But I think it very much depends on the individual. I mean, I've had PAs that have been with me for 6-7 years. And then I've had other people who haven't really lasted more than a few weeks. So it very much depends on a personality match. I think it's probably one of the most important things, you know, in a PA client relationship. As you said earlier, guys, that, you know, skills and training are kind of tailored to your own needs. So you give them along the way. I think it's a difficult one. I think a lot of PAs historically, especially when they were coming from Europe, you know, they would come here for a couple of years, earn some money, learn some English, and then go back to their home countries. So it will be interesting to see kind of like the longevity of British workers, whether they stick around in the job longer. I don't know. That will be, something we need to see. But it is a high turnover. And yeah, I've been lucky lately. I haven't had to recruit anyone, but you never know what's around the corner. But it's, you know, important to have a team of PAs and then a few as backup as well, if it's at all possible.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know you have kind of recently moved from South Africa. So you know what's happened like for you? Did you have PAs there with you? What happened?
Yeah, my journey's been a bit rough. So when I was 18 when my mum and dad found someone in the newspaper who was, at the time he was 33 years old, and he wanted to do housekeeping. And they rang him up and said, look, we do want you to do housekeeping, but we also have our son who's physically disabled. He needs help with everything. Would you be willing to give it a go? And he did. And I think that's one of the best things that my family ever did for me. Leonard looked after me for 15 years. He was part of my life. He went through everything with me, from moving out of home, building a career in South Africa, being in long-term relationships, helping me maintain those relationships, feed children, help me get them ready for school. He really was the greatest asset that I've ever had in my life, apart from my family and my partners that I've had. Leonard really just was like a family member. He was part of our family. He and I had such a great relationship. He named his firstborn son after me. And the trouble with this is moving to the UK is because of the immigration rules, he couldn't come with me as my carer because he was deemed as unskilled, because all he had was experience. He was too old. Because to get a work visa, you can't be older than 32 years old. When you're coming from a country that's not in the EU or in the UK. So it was really a very tough decision that we made to come here. And we had to do it in stages. My partner had to come to the UK with our daughter first. Our son then came over. And then I came over towards the end of 2020, and not having anything here. We had no support whatsoever. And my partner was doing a full-time job at home and then helping me with all my care as well. And that was obviously taking toll on the relationship. But we were getting on because we didn't have a choice. That's what we had to do. And social services got involved. I phoned them about a query that I had about getting vaccinated, and they then started asking me other questions like who's taking care of me, and that's how I ended up in the social system and getting social care. And it's been a major adjustment because it also depends who's looking after your case as well with social care. I went from a social care social worker helping me over the phone. And saying, well, what do you help with? And he's saying, okay, we'll give you 4 hours a day. When she went on maternity leave, the person who took over actually came to see me at home, saw the needs, saw a lot more questions, really tried to understand what my day-to-day living is like. My care packages skyrocketed to 86 hours a week. And I have a full-time sit. So I have two people that do one in the morning from a certain time to a certain time, and then another person comes in to change over and do the rest of the day until 5:30 in the evening. But I also have other people that come in to assist as I said earlier, with the bathroom breaks. And it took a while. I mean, that took 6 months to achieve. So it wasn't an easy road. It wasn't something that I'm even still used to now. I'm not used to it. I'm used to having the same person that I can always rely on. I know that I'm not going to be dropped at the drop of a hat and then someone has to be found to take their place. And it's challenging. My partner works away from home as well. So if carers are late, I'm not out of bed until they found someone come do that shift.
Yeah.
That's the risk we face with random people coming in and out, because there isn't that level of understanding that if I don't show up today, he's in trouble.
Yeah. And I think for me, you know, as well, I've seen that element of them not understanding that, you know, they, yes, they're coming to work, but they're coming to work enables me to work. And it's almost a little bit of a domino effect. If one of those dominoes falls, everything after it goes. And that can happen at any stage throughout the day. And, you know, I can be in a meeting at work and get a phone call, and I'm not always able to take that phone call. You know, so there is an element of almost type of work on making sure that you're able to balance your own life with the life of being your own little mini CEO of your own enterprise with no pay and no profit, really. You know, and people don't realise the effort that we have to put into that. So, you know, it's also important. I think it's important that we recognise PAs are skilled. And I think Louie's story really kind of talks about our skilled people. And that at the minute isn't really recognised. And we've touched on this a little bit already, but what does life without a PA look like? You know, how valuable are they that whenever they go away, you know, what changes, what falls apart when that domino effect hits them for you?
I think everything would fall apart. I think we are so reliant on assistance that our health would deteriorate. I think we would not be able to prove people wrong and show them that we can be part of society and contribute like everybody else. It essentially takes our lives away from us. We would be hermits because we would only be able to go out when family can take us out. I don't think many relationships between spouses and partners would last as long as they could have lasted, because there's a fine line that you tread between caring for someone and being in a relationship with someone, and you can't do both full time. It's impossible. While there are overlapping elements to both sides of that line, there has to be a differentiator. And without care, it's very, very unique individuals that can sustain that. I mean, I look at my partner's mum and dad. He's retired now, and he's been taking care of his wife for years now, and it works for them. She has MS, and she only really deteriorated in the middle of her life. And he's phenomenal. He takes care of her permanently now, and I just think that not everyone can do that. Not everyone is built the same way. So there are major impacts to us not having reliable people involved in our lives as PAs or there as our, as you said, our arms and legs or extensions of ourselves.
Yeah,
I mean, I totally agree with Louis. For me, without PAs, my life would be lifeless. You know, they are the foundation of my existence. So without a solid foundation, you can't build anything on top. You know, I wouldn't be financially independent. I wouldn't be emotionally independent. I wouldn't have been able to do the things that I've done and contributed to things I've done as well. And, you know, I also think, you know, another thing that people forget about is, okay, if we didn't have a PA, our health and physical health would decline, but also mental health, you know, and that's something which is so important. You need to live a full, you know, fulfilled life to have good mental health. And, you know, and without a PA, it wouldn't be possible. It wouldn't be possible. So, yeah, it's very important, really important role.
Yeah, and I think as I said, for me, it's the scramble. If a PA isn't well or something happens that they don't make it to work, it's that scramble. And sometimes you just don't have time to bring someone else in. So you're reliant on one or two PAs, so you know really you're relying on them for backup and they live the closest to you. But for me, it's moments of those little things. It's going to the toilet, it's having a meal, being able to drink. All those really basic functions that sustain our lives, they just immediately come fall by the wayside. PAs, it sounds like a luxury, but it's actually very much a necessity for people. And I think that's missed a lot by the public.
I think consistency as well is so important. It's exhausting when you have to kind of completely, it's literally like training a new PA is 24-hour, 7 days a week commentary, for 1 week, 2 weeks. Imagine if you have to continually do that. It's just, it takes up far too much of life and energy, and you just don't have anything left, to give. So, yeah, sorry, Louis.
I think you remind me that because I was going to say something exactly like that. No matter how many times I've spoken to the care agency about the impact of inconsistency and what it does to me, it falls on deaf ears. The promises are made and it doesn't really get done. But what I would say is, if I look back and I reflect, I was a very meek and meager person, very shy. I didn't want to get involved in conversations. I didn't really have a lot of friends. But the minute I had a PA in my life, and started to push those boundaries to go out and do things because I was with someone that I trusted. It really changed me and allowed me to become an individual rather than a person. It allowed me to pave my own way rather than follow like a sheep. And I think that is a stark contrast to what I was before I had a proper PA. But I will definitely get down that road again where I am in control of everything again and navigating that on my own without other people's and other external interference, because the way it is now, it's not the way it should be.
No. I think having a trusted PA just gives you confidence, and I think that is just priceless, because with confidence you can achieve anything. And that's just when you don't have to think about the day-to-day grind, getting up, going to the loo, who's going to dress you, who's going to make you tea. These are things we don't need to think about. We shouldn't have to think about these things.
I know for me, I've trained 2 new PAs this week, lucky me. So I spent the first 3 or 4 days of this week training new people and arranging DBS checks, because I'm able to arrange them right and they go through the training. And that's something that I set up very unique to me, because I feel safe enough to do that and I have the right safety protocols in place. And it's literally taken me all week to do that. But I know my other PAs are falling into place really well. So it allows me to focus my energy on that. So it is a big thing. Consistency is key to all of this. I think we all have SMA, and I think for a lot of us with SMA, we're very routine driven, because of the nature of who we are, and we don't have control over a lot of things, but that routine and that consistency allows us to relax and actually in the roundabout way does help our mental health as well, I think. It's a really important point around consistency and being able to rely on other people, which is a really hard thing to do. In terms of actual PAs, and the skills that they have, do you feel like it is still room? I think a lot of people out in the public maybe don't understand the skill that's involved. So, I mean, do both of you feel the same way? Do you think it's still room?
Yeah. Absolutely, it's definitely a skilled role. I think that it's a profession where you don't necessarily need the skills from the beginning because it's skills that can be taught. But a lot of people think it's just a job where you wipe people's bums and mop up a wee all the time, and it's not. It's much more than that. You know, I have one of my carers who's regular. She's an 18-year-old lady who, at first, I was like, there's no way she can do my care. Are you mad? And she may be in my words. She's one of the best carers I've ever had. She's, in terms of standard of care, her level is high as Leonard, who took care of me for 15 years. She can look at me and know that I'm not sitting straight. And that's a skill. That's not something that I've taught her. You know, I can only give so much as advice and tips and tricks on techniques to cater the care around my body and what I need and what I want from the individual. But it's up to the carer to take that knowledge and use it and develop the skill to take care of that, of a service user. And without that ability, they wouldn't be able to do this job properly. And that's why the standard is low, and that's why you see so many people are unhappy with who they have or what they're finding, because if you're not willing to do your side of the care, we as service users can give and give and give. It's not going to help.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there, well, you know, qualifications and experience are useful in the role of a PA, but I think, you know, there are personal qualities which are far more important. You can't cheat, you can't teach, you know, you can't get qualifications for. It's just, that's you as a person. And I think, you know, as long as you've got a willingness to listen and learn, you know, you're honest, reliable, you have empathy, and you're a caring nature, I think, you know, more people could do PA work, people that probably didn't realise or didn't even think about it because of the kind of social care image that's, you know, portrayed, as you said, you know, it's all about wiping bums, but it's not. It is much more than that, and you know, it's an opportunity to learn new skills, see new places, experience new things. You know, it's not just care constrained to, you know, within four walls. It could take you anywhere in the world, basically. And I think, yeah. So, yeah, for me, it takes a special kind of person with special qualities. I prefer kind of that over people that are qualified, you know, up to the eyeballs with care, because I think sometimes they think they know then how they should be caring for you, where, you know, as we've discussed, you know, it's very individual. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think sometimes qualifications get in the way because they are taught a certain way. And if that way doesn't work for the service user, what is the point in still applying that knowledge? Whilst it can come in handy and it can be applied, but the individual carer needs to be able to mold what they know around what is needed and what is required.
It's not a
one-size-fits-all exercise. It's not.
It's about being adaptable, isn't it? I think that's probably a good word to describe a PA, very adaptable.
Most of the carers that I've had around at my home have said that they never ever saw themselves in care, and now that they do it, they don't think they would want to do any other job because of how rewarding it is. Mm-hmm. Most of the management staff that have been in my home have said exactly the same thing. I recently did a talk for a college, a CV college in Benfleet, and I was giving my perspective as a service user, and both the supervisor and the manager that were with me were saying there, but said that they never ever imagined that they'd be in care, but there's nothing else they would rather do.
No, and I think, the talk about skills, you know, for me, I don't really care if you're qualified or not. You know, if you have a qualification to your name, great. But it's not going to help me make a decision as to whether you're the right person for the job. And actually, you know, in terms of movement and handling training, one of the things that is required for my insurance, but also required by my local authorities, that all of my staff are trained to an appropriate standard of movement and handling. And I very quickly discovered that the movement and handling training that was around was never going to train them in me. It was training them to encourage me to sit myself up, which is a skill I never gained, you know, from childhood to now. And I don't think I'm going to get it at this stage of 31. So I ended up asking some of my really trusted staff members if they would be open to going away and having training to do that, to be a trainer in moving and handling. So I brought all of that training in-house, and they're no longer trained generally. They still have their theory to do and their principles of moving and handling, but they now get trained with me in the bed, and they're practicing on me. And that has revolutionized the way people come in, because they know within their first shift what it's going to be like for them. And they also know the way my body moves is so differently to other people. And I think that really helped. So I do think they are skilled, but not in a way that they need to be qualified. For me, it's about being open to learning new things, having an open mind, and being able to learn the person and not be sit still. You know, and that is very skilled thing in and of itself. And kind of with that in mind, we touched on this already. We know there's a PA shortage. We know Brexit is making it more difficult. What do you think we can actually do about that? What are your solutions?
I think first and foremost, we need to differentiate the difference between a PA and a regular social care job, to try and entice people that maybe were put off by certain aspects of social care, but, you know, maybe would be interested in PA work. I think we need to sort the funding out, because, you know, we need to be able to pay a decent, fair wage for a job which is skilled. Okay, it might not be recognised as skilled, but it is skilled. We need to pay more than, you know, a dog walker or you could earn in Tesco's. Where there's no bum wiping involved. You know, we need to pay decent wages, but the funding needs to be sorted out. And I think we also need to encourage the government to generate a non-sponsored visa route so that individual employers and PAs can use that, because at the moment, yes, they did change the visa rules and with the shortage occupation visa, but unfortunately that doesn't really help individuals like us.
Well, I think you touched on a very key point there about funding. So in the recent study that I, or research that I've done, because I want to go into direct payments, they will not pay whatever the region rate is or county rate is. They will not pay a carer the same rate that they would pay an agency for that carer. I understand that there's overheads that an agency has to pay, but when you're talking about changing from, let's say, as an example, £20 an hour is what the agency will get paid. That agency is then paying half of that to the carer, and they're keeping half for themselves. But if you switch to direct payments, you still get your hours, but they won't pay £20 an hour. They reduce that rate down to 12. So, and sometimes as low as £9.50. So how do you go from no control and being and them paying more to gaining your control, but they're actually going to pay less? It doesn't work. It doesn't work. If you want that reliability and you want someone who is going to be there, they need to be rewarded for that. No one's going to stay for minimum wage. No one's going to stay for something that pays so little, and all it needs is someone to come along who says that they can pay more, and that person's going to be gone, because they have to think about themselves first.
It's really, yeah. Really, because, yeah, the agency's getting paid £20 an hour, okay, because they've got overheads and they've got other things, but, you know, you as an individual employer have got overheads and things to do as well, so, you know, are you doing that for free? You're doing all the work that an agency would be doing for free, in effect.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I would still pay the same rates for the carer whilst doing all that work, because I feel that they deserve that rate. Mm-hmm. But you, if you want them to pay even £15 an hour, you have to build such a strong case and such a great motivation for social care managers to approve it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, like, you know, we're talking about overheads. Sorry, Katy, I'm interrupting you there, but like,
no.
If you think of overheads, you know, you think of your traditional, you know, paper, ink, time, staff time. But actually, for me, it burns down to things like toilet roll.
Yeah, extra heating, extra electricity, extra water.
Yeah.
These things aren't factored in.
Yeah, sorry, Katy, I interrupted you.
I've forgotten what I was going to say anyway.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the overheads are not what people expect them to be. And I think we need to recognise that there are overheads there and there is cost. To have MPAs and personal dependence payment is not stretched to cover that, even remotely. Never mind the fact that so many of us have to pay our care component or our daily living component into our care. You know, it wouldn't even begin to cover the cost of having a PA in the house all of the time. And you know, that is part of the reason I think we can struggle to recruit, because, you know, we can't really advertise the amenities that we have because they're working in a home. You know, you see a job adverts all the time with ample free parking, free refreshments, and those are the sorts of things that I'm always reluctant to advertise, because one, I might be able to do it today, I might be able to do it tomorrow. And I don't like advertising that, because it depends on my own financial situation whether or not I'm able to do those sorts of things, like pay for a meal or pay for them to go to the cinema. So it's a massive part of the job, but it's not always something we can advertise, and I think that's an important point to make.
I hope Dermot can edit this out, but I'm going to have to ask us to try pick up the pace a little bit, because my carer is here and they've just told me they can't wait another 10 minutes.
Yes,
sorry.
I think that should be left in.
This is
the point, doesn't it?
I have one last question. So if we keep it to 30 seconds and I'll round off. And I suppose I've really talked about this. We do have a petition. There is a really tight closing date on it. We will include it, but please do look at the closing date, because I know it's really tight, to try and help get more people into the profession. And I would encourage everyone to sign up. But in 30 seconds, what is the number one thing we can do to attract more people into becoming PAs? Lady, do you want to go first?
Yeah, I think I would say definitely policies have to change. I think visa situation, as Katy mentioned earlier, definitely needs to change. I think that certain jobs shouldn't have an age limit. Care falls under general work visa. So if you're older than 32, you can't apply unless you are qualified up to the wazoo, which I think is extremely discriminative. I think that we also need to look at ways like Katy has been doing with her recent posts and marketing campaigns that she's coming up with, showing how rewarding this role can be and what a difference it makes to people's lives. I think that this role is just as valuable as doctors or nurses or military. It makes a major difference in people's lives every day.
Brilliant. Yeah. And Katy, what about for you?
I think Louis kind of summed it all up there for me, right? Yeah. I mean, all I can add to that is just reiterate, yeah, we need to inspire people to do this. We need to put it out there. I mean, personal assistance is kind of a fairly new role, really, I would say. It's probably not more than about 10, 15 years old that it's really kind of become a recognised job. So, yeah, we just need to get out there. But we need PAs to do that, obviously, and get out there, inspire people, and just live a life we can, and just show other people that that's what you can achieve.
Yeah, I think for me, very quickly to round it off, it's about two things. It's about us where we can, GDPR compliant, sharing our PAs with the world, and letting people see the things that they're getting to do with us. I think that is possibly the most powerful thing that we could do, and that we're in control of with our PAs. But also, I think, and this is specific to people in Northern Ireland, but hopefully we'll roll across the rest of the UK, has to respond to consultations regarding social care. We have the adult health and social care strategy out for consultation in Northern Ireland right now. Agencies are proposed to get over £18 an hour, and people like me who are on direct payments are down at £15 per hour. And I think we need to challenge that at government level and not be afraid to respond to a consultation when it pops up. So that is PAs and care in a nutshell. Being a PA isn't just for care. But I think we've talked a lot about lots of the issues that are so important. Thank you, Julie and Lee, for joining us.
Thank you.
Good to reach out to SMA UK if you have any questions. And we will see you on our next episode. Thank you.
You've been listening to the Living with SMA podcast. We hope you can join us again next time. But in the meantime, please don't forget to like and subscribe so you don't miss an episode. You can find out more on our website at smauk.org.uk.